2 Timothy chapter 4 verse 6. And now the time has come. Now Frank Sinatra and St. Paul had different life retrospectives. Paul's was in this verse. He said, "For I'm already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time has come for my departure." Now when Paul's anticipating his death, he uses this word analusis, and it's translated departure. And it's an interesting compound word from the root luo, which means to loose. And it reminds you of the untying of the ropes before a ship sets sail. And it's close to the Greek word apolusis, which means the shedding of a cocoon by a butterfly. I'm nearly done. Soon I will be set loose. Soon I am going to be free of the cocoon. I'm going to be free of the constraints of life. I'm ready. The ropes unloose and the ship moving slowly away. And this, of course, is the same root as our word, analysis, which technically means unravelling, something that unravels, or investigating when you split something into bits so that you can study it. And many commentators in the past have seen Paul referring to the unravelling of his body, you know, between spirit and soul. And mind or something. But I think it's wrong to be a bit over-exact here. It's more helpful to think of it just in the sense of, you know, they used to say it in pubs at 11 o'clock, they say, "Time, gentlemen, please." Just like saying, it's wrap-up time, it's nearly over. Departure time is here. Paul saw, this is almost certainly the last letter that he wrote. It's almost certainly one of the last things he has to say to us. And it's this: I'm ready to go. I'm anticipating my release. Now don't forget that he was a prisoner in chains. And he was comparing a setting free from the body to a setting free in death to a setting free from prison, from chains. And all his life journey with all its problems and issues was soon going to be done with. I remember hearing this story from Peter Maiden. He was describing a missionary couple staying with him who were on holiday and they were anticipating going back to the mission field. And when the kids of the family wanted to buy a bicycle, the mum and dad were saying, "No, because what are we going to do with it when we go back to on the mission?" And so they were anticipating their departure. Do you see where I'm coming from? And so they were sort of saying, I want to live in the light of where I'm going, not where I am now. What's the point of filling up my house with stuff that I'm not going to need? And it has to be like that for us, doesn't it? You really can't take it with you. And Paul saw his departure time coming and he told his friend Timothy he was ready to go. How can you so calmly face something like death? Paul's confidence was rooted in the past and in the future. In the past because of what he'd done with his life, and how he'd lived it, in the future because of where he knew where he was going. He knew what was coming. And that knowledge gave him peace and gave him comfort, gave him certainty. And here's what he says. He says three wonderful statements. He says, "I've fought a good fight. I've finished the race. I've kept the faith." What was the race? In Acts 20 verse 24 he says, "I consider my life nothing to me if only I may finish the race and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me. I've kept the faith." And in 1 Corinthians 4 he said, "Now it's required that those who've been given a trust must prove faithful." So according to Paul's words, he would be judged according to his faithfulness. Now, let me say, if there was ever any guy who ever lived who had a reason to have strayed from his faithfulness, Paul was that man. He had an awful time, an incredibly bad time, but he never strayed, he never gave up, he never relinquished the grip that Jesus had on him. So why is this important? What am I saying? Well, you see, it's because of that grip, it's because of that certainty that he had an assurance about what was to come. "Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day." Paul was looking forward to something, his departure, but it wasn't with trepidation or anxiety. It was for the wonderful welcome of Jesus, saying, "Well done, my good and faithful servant. You did it, man. You held on. You cracked it. Good lad." And then he takes it further, one step further, and he applies it to you and me. 2 Timothy 4:8. "Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to you, to all who have longed for his appearing." I want to claim that assurance for myself. I want to acknowledge that this life isn't everything that there is. I want to make a reservation for my eternity. Now, what does something like that mean? It simply means that I trust in Jesus now because Jesus has been this way before me. He has lived his life before God. He has died, and now he's with God. I want to go that way. I want to do what he did. And that's what Paul is saying right here. And paradoxically, that readiness to leave, that living and travelling light, travelling just with a suitcase, you might say, it meant that he was better able to cope with all the stuff that life threw at him. A reward, sure, but a better fight here too. There's an old cliche that you have to find something worth dying for in order to find a life worth living for. Paul had found both. And for him, it made life's problems possible to bear and death's fear possible to overcome. How about you? God bless you today.